Believe in the True Meaning of Christmas. Chapter 1. The Coming of the King. Who is Jesus? Written evidence of Christ's birthplace in a cave was found in writings in 160 AD. In 326 AD, Constantine was the first Roman emperor to convert to Christianity.
And his mother, Saint Helena, commissioned that a church be built over the cave. And without her mission in Jerusalem to build churches over sacred sites, such as the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, the Church of the Nativity, and the Garden of Gethsemane, those sites would have been lost forever. Despite her best efforts, however, the church was destroyed in 530 AD.
Today's rebuilt church is much larger, and there is much history to read about regarding the sacred place of Christ's birth.
The interior of the Church of the Nativity is impressive.
And once inside, you see the entrance to the sacred site called the Grotto of the Nativity, the place of Jesus' birth.
And although many things led to the Crimean War, the immediate cause of the war was religious conflict, particularly over protecting the holy places in Jerusalem. Today, the Grotto of the Nativity is maintained by three churches: the Roman Catholic, Armenian, and the Greek Orthodox.
Although a baby with basic needs and emotions, he was all-powerful and wise. He was God, entering the world in human flesh, the materialization of God embodied and dwelling in man.
We are created in the image of God, but Jesus is identical to God, revealed to us. Though his title was king, he was not considered royal in the defined sense of the word. But he had one great distinction, Chuck. He was a light of perfection that darkness could not extinguish.
There are more than 100 strong and powerful words to describe this Jesus. Born human, yet perfect.
Just a few to mention: Prince, Messiah, Lord, Redeemer, Savior, Miraculous, Incorruptible, Worshipped.
His name, Jesus. His mission, to save the world from a multitude of sins.
He came as a baby, born by virgin birth, teaching and sacrificing his own life to redeem us all.
So who, you might ask, is Jesus? The chapter of Colossians 1 says he is the Son brought to the manger in the invisible image of God, and seated at the right hand of God the Father. He is supreme. He is God come to earth to save mankind. Glory to God in the highest. His power is everlasting to everlasting.
And the angel came in unto her and said,
Hail, thou that art highly favored. The Lord is with thee. Blessed are those among women.
And when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, and cast in her mind what manner of salutation this might mean. And the angel said unto her,
Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb, and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. He shall be great, and shall be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of the father David. And he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end.
When we ponder the true meaning of Christmas, we usually think of Jesus as a baby in a manger. And while this event is truly miraculous, the main theme of the Christmas story is the affirmation that Christ was the coming of God in flesh, born among the masses. Now, although he was a baby with basic needs and emotions, he was powerful and wise. He was God, entering the world in human flesh, the materialization of God embodied and dwelling among mankind.
The heavenly angels sang, and the shepherds ran to the manger to witness the infant child, not in a royal palace, but in a cattle stall. This stirring anthem culminates into a masterful conclusion, proclaiming Jesus, God in the highest.
God has come to mankind, born a baby, but reigning in our lives today as King. Gloria in excelsis Deo, Latin, meaning glory to God in the highest.
Chapter 2, it's the song of Christmas, the greatest story and gift of all. The song of Christmas conveys to the listener the greatest story told to man, a tender message of peace and gift of hope offered through Jesus' birth. Looking back, the Bible and history have much to teach us.
As Christmas draws near, there's an excitement in the air as we gather with loved ones, recalling our most cherished memories of the season.
As a child, can you recall hearing the amazing story of Jesus' birth?
Have we misplaced the true meaning of Christmas with the fluff that often creates a season of stress? Does this scenario sound familiar?
Honey, help me! Can you believe all these gifts we have to buy?
Where in all the world are we going to find money to pay for these gifts?
If I have to rush out to buy one more gift, I'm going to scream. Oh dear, I can't do all this. Help, this is just too much.
Could it be, for another year, that the Bible has been left on the shelf collecting dust, becoming just an afterthought?
I know, Nancy, we should have made time to read the Christmas story to our children, but we just couldn't work it in. We're exhausted, and our kids needed to get to bed.
The real reason for this season is hopefully why you are here today, a chance to hear the greatest story once more, escaping the cumbersome and dreaded commercialism of the season.
It's hard to remember a time when just a few gifts were enough. The gift was meaningful, and the excitement was more about the family time together rather than the price of the gift.
During the Depression, it was hard to believe that a candy cane or an orange were the real treat left from Santa. Homegrown and homemade was the way of the day. Only those who lived where oranges grew, like California or Florida, had easy access to this expensive delicacy. It was an exciting gift for any household on Christmas Day.
And the distinctive menu for Christmas dinner was just anticipated indulgence, like brown sugar pie.
If there was any gift at all, it might have been a homemade, perhaps a wagon built with love or a hand-sewn doll.
Yes, Nancy, I know that was a century ago or more, but perhaps they had the right balance between the sacred worship and secularism. It's hard to imagine such a time, but it's true, the majority of our ancestors placed the season directly where it was in fact intended.
And where's that, Chuck?
At the foot of the manger, Nancy, where Jesus' birth was the priority of Christmas activities. Can you imagine a Sunday when all businesses were closed? Well, they couldn't imagine them being open.
Today it seems that material things play too much of a part of the season, rather than the comfort of a faith-based Christmas.
Jesus' birth is part of Christmas, which leaves a life map of guidance and a deep footprint in the heart of all who seek his grace.
You're so right. Presents provide short-term contentment, get thrown aside for another, and are seldom remembered. But a deep faith in Christ remains a solid rock of security and well-being. Now that's something money can't buy.
After the hype, presents, and all the mess, the day after Christmas can bring feelings of emptiness. It's the song of Christmas, clear and heart-touching.
Yes, I can hear it. The sound of peace on earth.
The greatest gift of Christmas cannot be found under the tree. This is the present that keeps on giving, giving, doesn't get old, nor go out of style, but consistently travels with you across the miles of your life. Even in your darkest need, he is always there as your chaperone. This babe come down from God's throne was born so simply, yet his story is the greatest story ever told. No one, no gift is more valuable.
Jesus knows every hair on your head and can offer hope beyond this world.
Now, folks, that's a gift. If you haven't already, receive God's greatest gift into your heart, the real gift of Christmas, Jesus.
And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly hosts praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men."
And it came to pass, as the angels were gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us now go even into Bethlehem and see this thing that has come to pass, which the Lord hath made known to us."
And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. And when they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning this child. And all they that heard it wondered at those things which were told them by the shepherds.
And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, as it was told unto them.
Thank you. It's the sound of falling snow as we hurry out to go, caroling with family and with friends.
It's the laughter everywhere by the fire we share, sweet memories we've made throughout the years. And as we gather close with those we love the most, we read the story of Jesus. Christmas time is here.
Chapter 3. Rejoice with exceeding great joy, the fine line between faith and foolishness, and the significance of the kings and the star. What causes someone to cross the boundary of faith and move into foolishness? Jesus says, "So then, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is."
Well, Chuck, how can I know whether I'm truly believing in God with my faith or behaving foolishly?
Well, Nancy, perhaps the easiest way is to test yourself, is to ask yourself a simple question.
And what question might that be?
Actually, a good place to start searching for this answer is to ask yourself, what makes you happy? What makes us happiest, Nancy, is really a reflection of our true values.
Well, I hate to admit it, Chuck, but faithful believers often do find happiness from getting things, or in getting power hungry, or seeking recognition and popularity.
There is no denying that earthly happiness is weighed by worldly things. However, the disciples gave up everything. Possessions, family, yes, absolutely everything, just to follow Jesus. However, because of the foolishness of man, few people are unable to completely give up worldly things we feel make us the happiest.
Well, perhaps Jesus doesn't expect ordinary man to give up everything, but he does expect us to change our perspective on those blessings by unselfishly sharing our faith, our wealth, helping the less fortunate, and following his commandments.
You're right. Proverbs says, many of the plans is in a man's heart, but it is the Lord's purpose that prevails. What is important is how we use the possessions we have, placing them in their prominent place, so we take a daily walk with Jesus.
Let us look at Jesus, who rejected in eternal things, who rejoiced in eternal things that really count, in the Holy Spirit, and how God's grace results in the salvation of lost souls. Salvation is from God, not man. There's not one man who is immortal on earth, and we should rejoice that God offers salvation. Without it, what is left to look forward to?
Looking closer, we realize worldly possessions that seem to make us the happiest evade us slowly. With age and wisdom, we find they lose their novelty, wither, get old, get passed on to someone else, or even auctioned to a stranger at some point along our journey.
Truly, Chuck, you can't take them with you, and they mean nothing in the end. Sooner or later, possessions we covet, places of position or fame, once perceived as important, fade.
You're right, Nancy. That treasured ring, well, no one wants it, and its only value is the cash that it will generate. The head of the organization that calls the shots will eventually realize if their purpose is to rule rather than to serve, people will recognize their misguided ways and, in fact, lose respect for them.
Yes, eventually we all face the fact that no one is irreplaceable. Someone is always waiting to take our place. Celebrity may have found you, but your good looks fade, your talent is surpassed, and you notice your fan base has deteriorated and you're no longer in the public eye. You were the most popular, the star of the team, and now your time has passed and your dusty trophy is pulled from the case or pushed to the back for newly celebrated recipients.
The scripture reminds us to understand the will of God and recognize the foolish man in the mirror. Many fail to acknowledge that worldly happiness just can't come close to the exceedingly great joy offered through the true belief and a faithful walk with Jesus Christ.
Let us rejoice in the supreme God who offers eternal happiness. We should rejoice for the faithful and pray for the lost. By nature, we are spiritually blind to the promises he freely offers and can easily miss out on life's greatest gift.
And what exactly is that gift, Nancy?
It's grace. Grace and atonement are the real gifts from God. You see, Chuck, God guarantees a new life beyond this world. And truly believing in the real birth of the Redeemer, we become a child of God.
Many people will say, I'm extremely happy. I don't need Jesus in my life.
That's true. Unfortunately, many turn away from his offer of grace, but life can change in the twinkling of an eye. As life rolls on like a bowling ball, hitting us with great force when we least expect it, and that's when hopelessness sets in and we need the arms of Jesus to carry us.
Today, God opens the door and asks you to come in and receive his grace. Cross the fine line of foolishness. to truly believing in Jesus as Savior, as our King.
Rejoice with exceeding great joy for God's gift lying in the manger, for he truly is the answer to true happiness and will provide real comfort when you need it most.
Although nobody knows absolutely for sure, it is presumed that there were three magi, based on the number of special gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Led by an amazing star unlike any other, one of wonder and so brilliant, they knew this was an extraordinary event. The Magi traveled a long distance from the east to see God incarnate through Jesus Christ. In those days, we have absolutely no idea the length of time it took to make such a trip, but it must have been important enough that the Magi felt it was worth their time.
Well, who were these Magi, Chuck?
Mentioned only in the Gospel of Matthew, the Magi were most likely three distinguished Persian foreigners from the East who were true accountants of the birth of Jesus, bringing gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Many pictures depict the shepherds and the Magi at the Nativity together, but actually the Magi came at a later time and visited Jesus in their home.
There is a golden tomb in the largest Gothic cathedral in Europe called the Cologne Cathedral.
Many scholars say this tomb holds the bones of these three wise magi.
Melchior, a Persian scholar, Caspar, an Indian scholar, and Balthazar, a Babylonian scholar. What about the three kings' gifts? Their gifts were kingly in nature, myrrh, a symbol of suffering, and the holy anointing oil for burial of the dead. Frankincense was a perfume used in prayer, and gold was a symbol of kingship and virtue.
In October of 2015, there was a rare planetary trio convergence of Venus, Jupiter, and Mars, with brightness and seen with the naked eye similar to the Star of Bethlehem. Some wonder whether this conjunction of the stars in this century has some prolific significance for Christ's return. Could its timing have something to do with the conflict and the deterring morals of our world?
Well, regardless of people's belief, history, and legend, if one does not believe in Jesus Christ, God tells us we cannot enter the kingdom of God. So the question, how can we be a witness for the gospel? Only God can intervene in the hearts of man, but each of us is given the opportunity to be that significant shining star for Christ. In a world filled with hate, indifference, and self-centeredness, and God will reward your efforts.
Now when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came three wise men from the east to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he is born the King of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east, and we have come here to worship him."
Now when Herod, when he had some privacy, he called the wise men to him and inquired of them diligently what time the star had appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search diligently for the young child. And when you have found him, bring me word again that I may come and worship him also."
When they had heard the king, they departed. And lo, the star, which they saw in the east, went before them, till it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceedingly great joy.
And when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary, his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented to him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh.
Royalty. In search of royalty. Kings. Seeking kings. And yes, another journey. These men of wisdom detected something new in the heavens.
They soon realized they were witness to a miracle. And when they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy and began to sojourn to the city of David and an audience with the Holy Child.
O'er mountains and valleys it led them that night, a star of most radiant light. The wise men rejoiced as they journeyed afar to behold such a beautiful sight. To behold such a beautiful star.
When they saw the star, they rejoiced with great joy. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with great joy. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with great joy. They rejoiced with exceeding great joy. Yes, others saw the star, but they followed it not. To them it would come and would pass. The wise men kept trusting with all of their hearts that the star would find the baby at last.
Chapter 4, Little Drummer Boy with Savior Glorious, What Gifts Do We Have to Offer Jesus? Originally entitled The Carol of the Drum, The Little Drummer Boy was written in 1941 by Catherine Davis, who wrote over 600 choral compositions and left all of her royalties to Wellesley College Music Department, where she had received her music degree.
The Carol of the Drum was first recorded in 1951 by the Austrian Trapp family singers, famous for their life story told in the movie Sound of Music. Similar to a French story of the 12th century, the story revolves around a poor little drummer boy who is summoned to the Nativity by the Magi.
Once the boy arrived, he realized he had no gift for the baby, other than the rhythm of the drum and sound of the rum-tum-tum. With the approval of the Virgin Mother, the boy was happy to play for the infant. And as he plays, I played my best for him, and he smiled at me.
And when we think of Christmas, we think of a time of giving, a time when we see the joy one has when receiving it. Since God has given us so many gifts of joy, you might ask, what gifts do I have to offer him?
He says we ought to support the weak. As we look outside of these walls, can you think of one thing to do that would support those in need? whatever that might be, God is pleased if done with the right heart and the right reason. For he tells us it is more blessed to give than to receive.
But if we look closer, what we have to offer is our time, our talent, support, our tithe, and our armor of faith. After all, what do most mothers and fathers hope for from their children? They just want the same: time, appreciation, support, and love.
Have you ever wondered the significance of the gifts the wise men brought to Jesus? Unusual gifts, to say the least, for a child. But like the wise men, we can offer our gifts to Jesus and receive the rewards he has promised.
A newborn king to see, pa-rum-pa-pum-pum. Our finest gifts we bring, pa-rum-pa-pum-pum, to lay before the king, pa-rum-pa-pum-pum, rum-pa-pum-pum, rum-pa-pum-pum. So to honor him, pa-rum-pa-pum-pum, when we come. Shall I play for you, pa-rum-pa-pum-pum, on my drum? Thank you.
Chapter 5. O Holy Night, can a song change a heart? In 1847, a Catholic church in France was planning the celebration of their newly renovated church pipe organ and needed a special song for the Christmas Eve service. The priest of the church asked the town poet Placide Capot de Rodemar to write the lyrics. However, Placide wasn't certain he was up to the task of portraying that holy night in Bethlehem. Using the actual scripture taken from Luke 2, he imagined witnessing the birth of Jesus. And as he penned the words of the now famous, O Holy Night, now Placide needed a tune to set to the lyrics.
And he asked his friend Adolf Adams, a trained musician, if he would write the music. Within 3 weeks, the masterpiece was ready for the Christmas Eve Mass. The people loved the piece. But once the church was advised that Adams was of Jewish ancestry and Placide left the church, the song was deemed unfit for performance in the church. However, the people continued to embrace and perform the song.
10 years later, an American abolitionist, John Sullivan Dwight, printed the song in his Dwight's Journal of Music, and the hymn quickly became one of the most beloved of the American Civil War.
In 1906, with the invention of the radio, Reginald Fessenden, a Canadian and colleague of Edison's, was experimenting with the new microphone and telegraph, and was the first to broadcast over the airwaves reading Luke 2 from the Bible. Everywhere, people began to hear Fessenden's voice. He then picked up his violin and began playing O Holy Night, branding it the first song ever played over the radio waves.
During the middle of a firefight in the Franco-Prussian War in 1870, a soldier astonished his comrades by jumping out of the trench and singing 3 verses of O Holy Night.
When he finished, a German soldier responded likewise, chanting boldly in German, the Martin Luther hymn, From Heaven Above to Earth I Come. The legend says that for the next 24 hours, in honor of Christmas Day, both sides ceased firing, branding O Holy Night from that day forward as one of the most cherished hymns around the world.
O Holy Night is a perfect example of power and spiritual significance can play in a song on the human spirit. When we turn our listening ear, we download its beauty, message, and emotional expression into a fountain of well-being, stirring us to think of the everlasting love of the Savior and the progression of our life towards eternity.
And this shall be a sign unto you. Ye shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly hosts praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men.
And it came to pass, as the angels were gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, Let us now go even unto Bethlehem, and see this thing which has come to pass, which the Lord hath made known to us. And they came with haste, and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger.
A song has the ability to affect one's faith through heart and mind, body and soul, creating a state of inexplicable joy, transcending cultural boundaries. Through the lyric and music, the musical performance opens the heart and can lead us to a spiritual awakening and wonder of the divine. As you listen to one of the most famous songs of all time, experience the thrill of hope for a weary world. And for a moment, let the spirit of its message change your heart.
finish the cue.
Holy night, the stars are brightly shining. It is the night of the dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining, till he appeared and the soul felt its worth. A thrill of hope the weary world rejoices, for yonder breaks a new and glorious morn. When Christ was born on high, oh, holy night, oh, night divine. Your King before him lowly bent, behold your King before him lowly bent.
Chapter 6. God bless us, everyone. The best Christmas gift is giving your heart to the one who gave his life for yours. Tiny Tim, while in the church, remarked to his father, Bob Cratchit, that he hoped his crutch would be a reminder to the congregation that the one who made the lame walk and the blind sight. God Bless Us Everyone is a rousing chorus and the most memorable song from the musical from the Charles Dickens story, A Christmas Carol. A song emphasizing the important significance of choosing the path of good over bad.
When forced to observe himself through the eyes of others, Ebenezer Scrooge began to reform his views. He was forced to face the realization that he was not a good man. The selfishness, greed, and mean-spirited manner in which he conducted himself in daily encounters with others hit him squarely between the eyes. Fortunately for Ebenezer, he saw the blunder of his ways. It hit a chord within his hard heart, and he finally grasped that he had missed the boat. He had so much, but because of his bitter heart, he had wasted away his riches and power and position. Looking from the outside, Scrooge was awakened by the ghost of present, past, and future, and finally saw the real man he had become.
God Bless Us Everyone is symbolic of the change of the heart of Mr. Scrooge. By watching the impoverished and their sufferings, illness that can quickly change a family, and the loss of loving family ties, the real spirit of Christmas was revealed to him. The simple message of love that Christ offers, not just for some people, but for all of his children, regardless of our flaws, position, or rank. He loves us all, even Scrooge.
Today, we ask you to reflect on the mirror of your life and choose to believe in a babe with a manger and accept the greatest gift that Christmas has to offer. Let his light be a beacon of light others recognize in you. The best Christmas gift you can give to every Scrooge you may meet is a heart that loves Jesus.
When the angel told the shepherds she brought great joy that would be for all people, this was a message from God, who sent his life for only our redemption. All we need do is accept his grace and follow him. Only this moment is guaranteed you. Let us celebrate God's Son's promise brought into the world as a tiny babe, the greatest gift we will receive this Christmas. May the peace of Christ's birth be with you now and in the days ahead. And the Huntington Court Choir wishes God's blessings on each and every one of you and a very Merry Christmas.
Christmas spirit.